One thing I neglected to say earlier is that we're very pleased to have here today a delegation from the Institute for New Economic Thinking Young Scholars Initiative. And I just wanted to note that one member of that group is a panelist here, and that's Clara, Elisabetta, Mattei.
Okay. I'm David Kendrick. This is the session on austerity. And we have Andreas and Stephanie, Antonio and Clara in this order. Okay. So,
okay. Well, first I would like to thank the organizers of this wonderful conference. I think it's very illuminating. To James Galbraith for putting together this gang and that has had a very productive discussion so far. Well, also, it's very nice to be here in Austin, Texas at this point. For me, it's my first time around. Well, I will talk about austerity and inequality, and well, trying to give some ideas and some empirical evidence on the relationship between the two dimensions or the two processes. Well, inequality. It's not necessary to stress it too much in this audience, but it's an important issue, has become a growing concern, not only for academics, but for policymakers, for the population at large, politicians, etc. Inequality matters for a variety of reasons, social justice, ethics, social cohesion, the impact that inequality may have on social cohesion, very relevant nowadays for Europe, distributive conflict, etc. And also, the impact on the sustainability of economic growth. International disparities also, and these have been exacerbated to some degree by austerity policies. Well, first, this was discussed in the previous session, but just to give some preliminaries, what is austerity? Well, when you talk to a non-economist, somebody that hasn't attended this kind of conference, and you say this is an austere person, this is austere household, this is austere society, you tend to identify with a good thing. I mean, somebody living within their means and et cetera. The bad name of austerity is because of the specific content that to certain economic policies have been given in the last several decades and more recently after the crisis of 2008 and 2009. And austerity here, basically we refer to policies that are first externally imposed. I think that's very important because you can impose austerity from abroad only to low and middle income economies or countries that are not very strong geopolitically. I mean, it's very difficult to think that austerity will be imposed on the US. Who is going to impose austerity on the US? On the UK, that was an example, but in 1976, there was an IMF program. I think it was under Harold Wilson or Macmillan. Harold Macmillan, I don't remember well. It was an austerity program with the IMF signed by the British government. And so it was probably the last case before the last wave of programs of 2008 that the high-income nation had austerity programs formally. Well, austerity, we know, basically amount to cuts in social spending, in public infrastructure, weakening of social rights, privatization of public assets, and usually lead to protracted stagnation and contraction. If you read the programs agreed with or imposed with Greece or with Portugal or with Ireland and the austerity programs or the programs with Latin American countries in the past, you will see in some guise or the other all these elements are present. Well, the second point is to what extent all economic and financial crises are followed by austerity policies or not. And here the international evidence and the historical evidence is mixed. In Latin America, in the, let's say, in the debt crisis of the 1980s, most of the countries applied agreed programs with the International Monetary Fund that basically had the standard component of austerity, okay? Then the Mexico tequila crisis in 2004 was a little different because they received a big loan, $50 billion from the US, because the U.S. was afraid that the social destabilization in Mexico coming from an economic crisis would prompt massive migration. So they a lesson that has not been learned by some European countries this time. But so it was partially followed by austerity. The East Asian crisis of 1997-98 also were followed by some degree of austerity, a mix of funding, financing the crisis, and austerity or internal adjustment. Then the crisis of 2008 and 9, in countries like the US, the UK, and some other European nations, were followed, and that was a twist in the official position of the IMF, by a fiscal expansion, not a fiscal contraction. So that was quite inimical to the standard package of austerity. But that lasted just two years. Then they switched to fiscal targets or a concern to reduce the fiscal deficit and also to contain the growth of debt, which has not happened, by the way. Debt to GDP ratios have increased in most countries in Europe after the crisis of 2008 and 2009, in spite of internal adjustment. So not all crises are followed by austerity. In general, austerity is imposed to middle-income countries, relatively weaker countries, or not so big countries, and the others are saved. Well, the effects we know. In general, austerity policies are followed by cuts in GDP growth, maybe negative growth or stagnation, etc. They're quite disruptive. Higher unemployment, particularly among the youth, unemployment rates of the order of 50-60% for people, working people between 18 and 24 were not common in Greece, in Spain, and other countries in Europe. Also, real investment, real wage have been affected. Inequality. Well, here, the first thing to notice is that austerity policies, in terms of evaluating their impact on inequality, are coming in countries that have already experienced an increase in inequality. This is a relatively global or international trend, and that we can observe in other countries. So austerity is exacerbating inequality in terms of their direct effects and also the policy response followed to the crisis. And here, just the numbers, we know this, the data of the share of the top 1%, the income share of the top 1% in English-speaking countries, a long historical series of 100 years, drawn from the World Top Income Database. And what you see there is basically that around the early 1980s, you see an increase in the share of the top 1%, and the increase is more pronounced in the US, okay? But in general, for Australia, Canada, UK, New Zealand, Ireland, US, you see an upward trend there. So austerity is coming on top of this trend of redistribution of income and redistribution of wealth toward the elites, the economic elites, let's say top 1%. Another trend is that we see that the middle class is being, in many countries, squeezed. Or we need to understand better what are the effects on the middle class. Because in some countries, let's say in China, in India, in Latin America, even in sub-Saharan Africa, there is a talk that many people have left poverty, entered a so-called middle class measured by income. That may be true, that there is a whole discussion of what is the middle class. But if the increase in economic growth until recently in some countries led to an increase in the size of the middle class, if the increase in growth has come along with an increase in inequality, we see here there is a negative relationship between the size of the middle class and the inequality. In the horizontal axis, we have the Gini coefficient. In the very vertical axis, we have the share of the middle class measured from decile 3 to 9. And we see the blue dotted lines is the relationship between the income Gini and the share of the middle class, and the red dotted points is the relationship between personal wealth and the middle class. And we see that there is an inverse relationship between middle class and inequality, stronger and more precise with a lower variation around the, let's say, the regression line for income than for wealth. So that's a second trend, I would say, is more or less global. The third one is what we maybe call a working class squeeze, measures as declining labor shares. We have four main economies, the US, Japan, China, and Germany, in the last 40, 30 years, it depends on when we have data available. And in all four countries, we see a reduction in the proportion of national incomes that goes to wages and salaries. Okay, that's another trend that is underlying the shift, the austerity. Well, here we have the Gini coefficients for the US from 1950 to 2010, and the Gini coefficient for the UK, two main mature capitalist economies that embrace some sort of neoliberal policy or free market policy since the 80s. And you see an upward trend in inequality in these countries. Well, the wealth Gini coefficients are much higher. Here I just quote four countries, US, UK, Russia, and China. Russia extremely high Gini, wealth Gini, which is a strong departure from the socialist period. And then incomes, wealth Gini of that size. Latin America is a region with substantially higher inequality of both gross income and disposable income compared with the OECD and the world economy. Before taxes and transfer, the Gini coefficient is 53%, Latin America 47% in the OECD, 40% in the world. The difference is not that large when you consider gross income, but when you consider disposable income, the difference is much more substantial, okay, between Latin America and the OECD. And wealth, well, here are the numbers of the Gini for wealth. Well, Latin America, there is an interesting trend here is that if you plot GDP, the logarithm of GDP per capita, and the Gini coefficient for nine Latin American economies, you will see that the red line is the Gini coefficient and the blue line is GDP, showed to see whether there is a connection between the growth cycle with inequality cycle or inequality process. And you see that in Latin America in the last 10 years, this may have changed in the last 2 years probably, a little bit, we see a decline in the Gini coefficients along with an increase in GDP growth. It's not clear, there are some hypotheses, growth may have turned out to be a little bit more pro-poor in some countries. Pedro was saying that in Ecuador, all these sides were increasing their share, cannot increase at the same for all, but the absolute level with economic growth. So in Latin America, it seems that the shift away a little bit from the Washington consensus in several countries of the region, along that strengthened social policies, along with the effect of growth and some redistribution in some of the countries, have improved the GDP. This is a different trend that you observe, let's say, in the US. So the story for the Americas is different. Latin America, for the first time, may have turned toward declining inequality and North America toward increasing. Well, what happened if we consider wealth concentration? Here, I draw from the Global Wealth Report, the Global Wealth Report produced by the Credit Suisse, by Professor Tony Shorrocks and Jim Davis and Juberas from Uruguay, that every year produces statistics on personal wealth distribution for a big number of countries. Okay, some countries have wealth surveys, other countries have household panels, other produce estimates, etc. And here what I did was produce this table with the percentage change of the wealth share of the top decile, which is on the left-hand side, and the percentage change of the top 1%, of the top percentile wealth, comparing 2008 to 2000 and 2008 in the run-up to the crisis, and 2008 and 2014 after the crisis or during the crisis, okay? And you see here that there's a very significant increase in the wealth share of the top 1% in countries like Argentina, 60.4 4%, according to the Credit Suisse. In Brazil, quite substantial in the last 7 years. In Chile, 70%. In Colombia, there is a decline. We see in Germany, in Europe, Italy here, okay, Sweden, the UK. Perhaps the next table that separate separate core economies and European periphery. Core economy, Canada, France, Germany, Japan, the UK, the US, and the European periphery would be Greece, Italy, Ireland, Portugal, and Spain. And you compare the evolution of the wealth share in the two set of countries. And again, here the numbers are quite shocking. Greece, whose GDP has contracted by 27-28%, has seen an increase in the wealth share of the top 1% of 41.5%. Very dramatic worsening wealth distribution in an austerity country. Also Italy, which is not the same austerity that Greece, but also has seen 25% increase in the wealth share. Okay, Portugal 13.8% and Spain almost 21%. Okay, so the country that has suffered the most in austerity in the developed world, okay, have experienced a negative wealth distribution. The numbers here for the core economies are smaller, but let's say France, traditionally egalitarian country, capitalist egalitarian, has increased 16%, the UK 10%. The US shows a decline here in the share. Okay, I will stop here. I don't have time to disentangle what factors may have been working on behind these results, but I think the story for wealth and for income has to do with taxes, with very high CEO compensation, with market concentration and monopolization. That explains part the shift of income and wealth to the top. The factors that amount for a decline in labor share have to do probably with deunionization, immigration, outsourcing, labor saving, technical progress. It's a complex story, but you have to. Well, finally here, I will not discuss Latin America. Two, 3 points before the moderators get the matter. What can be done to reduce inequality? And austerity is not good for inequality. It's like smoking is not good for your health. Austerity is not good for inequality. So austerity will clearly will not be a solution. On the contrary, it will make things worsen. Well, first, very quickly, recognize that inequality is a problem. For many of us, this seems to be an obvious thing, not for many governments. Okay, that's a very important thing. Second, you have to manage redistribution in a sound way, both economically and politically. How to overcome a blockade by the elites of income and wealth redistribution. That's extremely important. It's a political question, it's an economic question. Keep the economy growing to the extent that it's possible. Distributive conflict will be less serious if the economy is growing rather than if the economy is shrinking. Look at direct taxation. Piketty's suggestion of increasing marginal income tax rate, wealth tax, etc. I stop here. I think you have to do some things with key markets. Basically, what is the wage setting institution we have in place? We have to move to more universal social policies, etc. And there is an open discussion of what to do with public ownership versus privatization, etc. I will stop here. I think inequality is worse, has been worsening, has been in a trend toward increased income concentration, wealth concentration the last 2-3 decades, and austerity policies in the last 6-7 years for the countries that have applied those policies have made things worse. But we need to understand better what's going on behind this. Okay, thank you very much.
Chris,
sorry for exceeding the time.
Here. I would like to
talk about the 3 points. The first one is the austerity, but so many things have been said here, meaningful things, that it's not so easy to add something of intelligence. I would like to synthesize, saying that this is a matter of fact, that after 7 years of a crisis, the austerity policy, that is the main policy in the Eurozone, is a failure. We can say this, very fairly to say this. The performance of Eurozone is the worst among the capitalist countries. It has been mentioned in the United States, but not only. Also, if you think to other European countries, as the UK, or Sweden, or Poland, each of these countries had reached a better performance in the last years. It's not the case for the Eurozone. Giovannoni mentioned something very interesting. In 2010, the unemployment, remember this, was the same level in the US and in Eurozone.
I know that a lot of my American friends criticize the US policy. And maybe they are right. But in any case, the unemployment in the US is half, 5% more or less, and in the US is increased. But it is not enough to say or to remember these figures. They are something that is incredible and paradoxal. The example that they put is now Spain. Each country has to imitate Spain, but the debt of Spain is more than doubled. Who remember that Spain had only 40% of debt at the beginning of the crisis, much less than the German debt. Now is more than double, is almost 100 of the GDP. And the unemployment in Spain was high, but more or less 10-12%. Now is 22%. Just Greece, sadly, has more unemployment. And they say the Spain is an successful example. This is a very... In Italy, there is an argument in these weeks. The increase in the current year is 0.8, or is it 0.9? This is the most important argument in the Italian political debate. And we see our prime minister, Matteo Renzi, going to the television to say, the crisis has overcome. We begin after 3 years of recession. 3 years of recession. These are the paradox of the Eurozone. It is unuseful to continue to discuss about the Eurozone policies. It's a failure. Sometimes we remember or we recall the 99 crisis. There are so many differences, but something is a meaningful. In the first 2 years of the US crisis of the 30s, we had you had in the US a Treasury minister, Andrew Mellon, who was convinced that the deflation was a good medicine to overcome the crisis. In the US, you had been lucky because after Mellon, you had Franklin Delano Roosevelt. We have something like Mellon, but in the horizon, there is not any Franklin Delano. Well, if the European Commission is a technocratic institution, but also political institution, if they had to choose a party, I suppose that the reference party would be the Republican Party in the US. This is very sad, but this is the reality. Let me come to the second point that maybe is more interesting, maybe. Once ascertained the failure of the policy, of the austerity policy, we can say that no one really believes now in the austerity. No Mario Draghi, the president of ECB. They believe in another thing, structural reform. There is an important shift from austerity to structural reforms. When Draghi talks about the perspective, he says that is no good perspective in Europe until when we perform, we realize the structural reform. What are they? It's very easy. You can write many essays, or many articles, or write a book, but in extreme synthesis, structural reforms are, you have said, privatization first. Second, cut in the social expenditure, cut in the welfare. Third, from my point of view, I am an old unionist. Most important is an attack to the trade unions, to the labor movement, with the reforms that mean fundamentally the freedom of dismissal workers. Also here, to synthesize, this is an attack to the social European model. But I want to conclude this with this second point, saying something that maybe is very radical. But I would say that in the Eurozone now is subjected to a kind of neo-Thatcherism. We have the history teaches something, no? We can utilize. Thatcherism was limited to UK. Now is shifted to the continent. We have a sort of neo-Thatcherism. If you want, I know that this is a very political assertion, but I would say that the combination between austerity and the structural reforms cannot be considered a pure political mistake. There is no mistake. It has become an instrument of an undeclared, but very harsh, very strong class struggle. Is it possible to mention class struggle? I think that in the Eurozone we witness a class struggle, a hidden class struggle. It is not necessary to mention Karl Marx. It's very clear to see what happens, and you have explained before about inequality. Let's see, come to the third and the final remark. The policy of austerity and the structural reforms could not be carried out without the compliance and also the complicity of the national governments. It was impossible for the Commission, supported by the German government, to implement these policies without the acquiescence of the national government. But something is happening. The the mainstream parties and the government are very destabilized. I would say agonizing. Look at France. I'm not a specialist of France, but everyone knows that François Hollande is the president with less popular consensus in the history of the Fifth Republic. This is a matter of facts. In Italy, Matteo Renzi had to seek the help of parliamentarians coming from the Berlusconi party to implement its right-wing, very right-wing, very dangerous constitutional, electoral, and labor reforms. Reforms that could make the envy of past Berlusconi government. And what remains of Berlusconi party now has declared that they will approve the stabilization law, the financial law of Matteo Renzi. This is the end of the traditional alternative between center-left, center-right, left-right. Now they are all for the European austerity and, first of all, social reform structure. And what is possible to do? Very complicated things, or very simple, maybe very easy. You can't continue with the current goal, objective, that is the zero deficit or the budget balance, zero deficit, in the next 2 or 3 years. This is absurd. This is totally crazy, because when you have recession and when you have this level of unemployment, you can't realize this objective. There is some party or some wing of a party or movement that is able to say that the king is naked. It's impossible. You can't realize zero deficit in a framework of recession and this kind of unemployment, because you will have the success of a nationalist, of Marine Le Pen, France, etc., etc. There is one possibility. Given that Mario Draghi, the ECB president, is the quantitative easing, it means that you can have so much money how you want, but the private are not able to utilize these resources for investment. They don't invest. They are intelligent people. They can't invest if there is not demand. But the state can invest, because the money is so available. There is one trillion euro available by the ECB with interest rate close or below zero. How and when can you make investment if not when money is available and the cost of money is zero or negative, because there is, in any case, a small inflation? This is a chance. This is a possibility. One example. If Italy, but the same you can say for his France, if Italy renounces to the zero objective in the next 3 years, there will be available 100,000 billion to invest. It's fantastic. It's as in the US, to have a trillion to invest. This is the chance to overcome the crisis, to have a growth. And when the growth will reach 3%, I have finished,
I would like to be a student in your class, so love the way you teach. Right? It's just, I'm getting signals from several.
My speech is finished. Thank you,
AJ. Thank you very much.
This is the view from my perspective, working on the Senate Budget Committee in Washington, D.C. This is a graph that I see more than I care to admit. This is a variation on a debt projection that is put out by the Congressional Budget Office, which is the main budgeting office. In fact, we work quite closely with them. In fact, they work for us. And this is a graph that we see in hearings. There's a colleague of mine, Matt Stoller, somewhere here in the room. I think we had 6 budget hearings in the first 5 months after I arrived in Washington, D.C. 4 of them had some title like The Debt Crisis in America. And so we wrestled, the senators on the Budget Committee wrestled with this picture, okay, which is meant to depict a looming fiscal crisis. Okay? If it were just that report that is put out periodically by the Congressional Budget Office, you might be able to just sort of put the thing on the shelf and forget about it. But unfortunately, it's not just that budget report. It is a much bigger problem, and it's one that we discussed a little bit today. So let me give you some indication of what it is exactly that we are up against in the battle against austerity.
Taking money from our children and borrowing from China.
To take out a credit card from the Bank of China in the name of our children, driving up our national debt that we are going to have to pay back. That's irresponsible. It's unpatriotic.
The government's irresponsible spending is turning us into slaves. You might well literally lock us into chains, at least our children.
We got to deal with this big long-term debt problem, or it will deal with us.
And
I'm asking you, join us to stop this fiscal train wreck. Join us to protect our children from an inferior standard of living, from a crushing burden of debt and taxes.
Okay, I don't believe in any of the tax cuts. I didn't want tax cuts for the rich. I didn't even want it for the middle class. Okay, because you know why? Because it puts a $400 billion hole in the budget and we just can't afford it.
And as we discuss deficit reduction, which is clearly a major issue.
For decades, we have piled deficit upon deficit, mortgaging our future and our children's future.
And the deficit thing is real, and the debt thing is real. We are really in trouble on it at some point.
There's a need for comprehensive deficit reduction.
The answer is not only yes, but hell yes.
This debt that hangs over our head, a government that spends more money than it takes in. That's not sustainable.
You know, you cannot cut taxes or increase spending unless you can pay for it.
The math of federal spending does not add up.
And we are spending money we do not have.
We have a debt burden that's crushing us.
To me, this is more of a moral issue.
It is.
You can't steal from your kids and grandkids.
Deficit. We think the deficit and the national debt are at a moral level.
National debt is America's biggest problem.
Right. So they say that nobody in Washington agrees on anything. This is completely untrue. There is widespread agreement on the broad problem we face, which is that we have out-of-control spending, deficits, and a looming debt crisis. It's immoral. It's unpatriotic. It is a burden on the next generation. It is something we must begin to tackle. The question is not whether we have a debt crisis that warrants the use of austerity to deal with the problem, but exactly how we should go about dealing with the problem. For all intents and purposes, we have two parties, two political parties in this country. And one party says, yes, we have a deficit crisis, and the way to deal with that is to get more revenue. So they want higher taxes to solve the crisis. The other side says, no, it's not a revenue problem. What we have is a spending problem. What we need is to lower spending, particularly spending on the various entitlement programs, Social Security, Medicare, Medicaid, okay? So the battle is over how to do it, not whether to do it, and a secondary battle is over how quickly to get it done, okay? Some people say we should do it, you know, it's like a Band-Aid. You just have to rip it right off. Take the pain, get the budget in balance, and do it very, very quickly. These are the austerity hardcore, right? Austerity now. Get a constitutional amendment in place to ensure that the budget will always be in balance going forward. Sometimes you even hear these folks say things like, let's go back on a gold standard, where we don't have the flexibility that the modern fiat monetary system gives us, which allows us to run these deficits. Let's constrain ourselves. Let's put the handcuffs on and get to a balanced budget in every period of time, calendar year, fiscal year, lunar year, whatever it is. I want the budget in balance at all points in time. And then you have sort of the deficit light, austerity light, that sometimes sound to me a little bit like deficit apologists, which is to say they acknowledge that deficits are something we wish we could avoid. It's unfortunate that we sometimes have to engage in this very bad and risky behavior, but every once in a while when the economy is weak, there is cause for increased spending to sort of prime the pump and get the economy going again. Therefore, we are willing to tolerate deficits in the downturn, but as the economy begins to improve and the business cycle swings up, that's when we choose austerity, right? And so we will balance the budget over the course of the cycle, but not in any particular year. No one, or essentially no one, asks another question, which is why austerity? What is the justification for either spending less or raising taxes? What are the economic effects? And when are the conditions ripe for raising taxes or cutting spending? So I like this Twain quote. It ain't what you know that gets you into trouble, it's what you know for sure that just ain't so. What if a lot of the things that we know for sure, and here I'm indicting to some extent my profession, I'm talking about professional academic economists, practitioners, technocrats. What are the things that we know for sure that just ain't so? Or maybe we ought to at least explore the possibility that they just ain't so. What if, in fact, deficits don't crowd out private investment? What if deficits don't drive up interest rates? What if investment doesn't depend upon higher savings? What if the debt actually isn't a burden on future generations? What if it's more of a distributional question where all future generations consist of both taxpayers and bondholders? And so the question we should be focused on is distribution, not this possibility of burdening an entire generation, which in fact you cannot do. What if China isn't really our banker? What if the debt currently isn't on an unsustainable trajectory? What if a deficit is not evidence of fiscal irresponsibility? What if it's not a problem that needs to be fixed? What if we're just looking at this question all wrong? In fact, what if in a country like the United States, that is one that runs persistent trade deficits, what if we actually need the government to be in deficit most of the time? These are the sorts of things that I hope that maybe we can begin to explore a little bit. Almost everybody is missing this, but not everyone. This is a graph put together by Jan Hatzius, who's the chief economist at Goldman Sachs. Hatzius understands that there is a relationship between what's happening on the government's balance sheet and what's happening on the balance sheets of players in the private sector, agent firms and households. And that is to say, here's the Great Recession, right? This is when the government's deficit shoots up to 10, 11% of GDP, and the panic begins to set in. But Hatzius and a handful of others recognized that on the other side of the balance sheet is this huge buildup of a surplus in the private sector. But for those huge government deficits, the private sector does not begin to accumulate that surplus, repair balance sheets, pay down debt, and begin to recover from the Great Recession. So as the panic sets in Washington, they see the deficit explode. And they say, my God, this is horrible, we have to do something. And do something meant establish a commission to tell us how to reduce the size of the government deficit. So President Obama says, look, we're out of money, we need a plan. And the plan comes from this Simpson-Bowles Commission that some of you may have heard of. These guys got together with a group of others, and they came up with a plan to cut $4.1 trillion from the deficit over the next 10 years. Hardcore austerity. And it freaked some people out. To a lot of people, it sounded like good common sense, right? Good fiscally responsible, let's get the deficits down, go ahead, you have a plan. But to some people, for example, those advising, those investors at Fidelity, advising clients, it sounded like madness. This was huge austerity imposed on an economy that was still quite fragile coming out of the Great Recession. And Fidelity said, this is a huge threat to corporate profits. And you say, why would Fidelity call deficit reduction a threat to corporate profits? I thought the whole argument was that what corporations really needed was a plan from their government. Show us you're serious about bringing down deficits, and that will bring confidence to the business community, and they will then engage in hiring and investing and so forth, but they need to see those deficits come down first. No, Fidelity said if you go forward with this, you're gonna massively kill corporate profits. How on earth could that be? I thought government deficits crowd out private investment. Wait a minute, something's not right in the world. And what Fidelity did was explain to their investors using, of all things, the Kolesky profit equation that government deficits are a source of, that's a plus sign, corporate profits, government deficits add to corporate profits, whereas personal saving, of course, subtracts from corporate profits. So they run through this for their investors saying, after the Great Recession, government deficits fostered a quick recovery in profits. This was a good thing, and now they're talking about massively reducing deficits through austerity, and it has the potential to reduce corporate profits, they estimated, by as much as 31%. That would have been massive, right? So here we are today. Deficits are falling, and they're falling fast, and they're projected to fall further. These are CBO projections. Here we are today looking at a deficit this year of something like 2.5% of GDP. 2 years from now, we'll be closer to 2% of GDP, and the celebration has ensued, right? We're doing a great job here bringing down deficits, except in 11 of the last 16 quarters, total government spending has been a drag, that is, has had a negative effect on total GDP growth. This is from Moody's, put out just last week, also showing that for a time we had stimulus and we had a benefit to in terms of real GDP growth from the fiscal side, but since 2011, austerity has set in and we have actually been adding drag to the economy. So my point is that not only can the deficit be too big, and that I think would manifest in the form of inflation, but deficits can actually also be too small. But nobody ever tells us that. Not only that, the deficit is actually mostly, at least in the US, automatic. That is endogenous. This is, I think, a pretty striking example of that. So what you have on the bottom half of the graph here is the budget outcome, federal budget outcome, and in the top half, the unemployment rate. Now, it's not a perfect mirror image, but it's awful darn close. Why does it look like that? Because when the unemployment rate is being driven up in a weak economy, people lose their jobs, they lose their income, they don't pay income taxes, tax receipts fall off a cliff, and spending to support the unemployed in the form of unemployment compensation, and food stamps, and Medicaid, and all the other programs that are there, goes up. The deficit increases automatically. And what happened during the Great Recession? Same thing. You're hemorrhaging jobs. 800,000 jobs a month are being lost. The deficit explodes. As the recovery sets in, the deficit begins to fall as the unemployment rate comes down. But we're convinced that, or at least policymakers are convinced, that when they see the deficit moving in a direction that they don't like, it's like when your car starts to go off the road and you're skidding out of control, your instinct, your impulse is to take the wheel and turn it the opposite direction, to correct the slide. But what does a car manual tell you to do? It tells you to do exactly the opposite. You're supposed to turn into the slide. That's how you regain balance. Okay, so what I'm suggesting is that the austerity does exactly what you said. You impose austerity, the deficit doesn't get smaller, the debt to GDP ratio doesn't go down, these things go up. The impulse is wrong. So how do we get politicians to begin to understand how to more responsibly and responsively use their powers? I'm not sure we do, which is why I sort of like the idea of finding a way to turbocharge the automatic stabilizers. We have automatic stabilizers. They saved us many times before, including the Great Recession. But maybe we can make them stronger. Maybe we could come up with some sort of a fiscal analog to the Taylor rule. Maybe we could take the dysfunctional decision-making from Washington sort of out of the equation and find rules to guide the proper use of fiscal policy, or something along those lines. So anyway, lots of people are beginning to recognize this, and on a closing note, let me just say that it's sort of interesting now, right? Because we have these two elections behind us. In the case of Jeremy Corbyn in the UK, you had a more unapologetic, unabashed, we're going to do infrastructure and other sorts of things, and we have our own central bank, and these guys are going to help us pay for stuff. That's essentially what Corbyn did. He called it people's quantitative easing, which I think you also alluded to, the idea that you can do QE for the banks, but never will the people get their hands on the money, right? Well, this is what Corbyn said. We're going to do quantitative easing, but we're going to use the central bank to finance the investments in our infrastructure. In Canada more recently, Trudeau wins, and he's up against the NDP and the Conservative Party, both of whom are pledging to balance budgets quickly, right? Both of them. He says, no, we're going to run deficits for a while, and we're going to focus on broader macroeconomic goals like growth and employment and inequality and so forth, and he wins. So it does give me a little bit of hope that maybe we'll eventually get to the point where we have people here who are willing to take a more ambitious look at austerity and fiscal policy. I'm sorry, I went a little bit over. All right.
Okay, thanks you very much for inviting me. I'm very proud to represent the Young Scholar Initiative here. And I believe that in present public and academic debate, there is the tendency to naturalize austerity, while given austerity history is very important. And the history of austerity dates back well before the neoliberal policies of the Reagan and Thatcher era. In fact, it was after World War I that unprecedented public debt and revolutionary events brought austerity to the top of the agenda of all Western allied countries. And budget deficit and price deflation, as we see now, became the main agenda. So one must keep in mind that the years 1918-1920 were the years of greatest socioeconomic upheaval in capitalist history. Workers demanded greater economic democracy, labor unions had gained bargaining power, and the state actually undertook expansionary fiscal policies to fulfill the demands of greater social security and public benefits. So in this context, if one looks at the wait, I'll switch it off later, otherwise you start reading. if one looks at the newspapers of the time, it is clear that the bourgeoisie had a catastrophic perception of what was going on, and they believed the specter of communism and socialism was at the door. And this is, for example, taken from Corriere della Sera. It's a liberal newspaper in Italy, purchasable now, and we read Einaudi saying, "The victory of socialism seemed too close and too easy. It was the time in which one would speak of the bourgeoisie as a corrupt social class, in which it would seem that a shoulder shove would suffice to knock the so-called capitalism regime to the ground. The communistic millennium seemed near, the reign of equality close to ensue." So, and this you can read in any newspaper, actually, of those years. So it is in this radicalized socio-economic circumstances that the combination of economic technocracy with austerity acted as a powerful tool for securing compliance with post-war stabilization. And austerity policies were implemented all over Europe. And in fact, the drastic deflationary wave brought soaring unemployment and suppressed labor class claim. And thus, finally, the pre-war hierarchical status quo was restored. And this is to give you just an example. This is the deflationary wave in the UK that started in March of 1920. That was followed by a peak of unemployment. And finally, a major decrease in the industrial militancy. We see of the number of strikes drastically decreasing very, very quickly. Nonetheless, it is Italy in the 1920s that represents the most emblematic and also dramatic case of austerity policies in the 1920s, especially because it shows this tight link between austerity, technocracy, and repression, which really comes into light. So Mussolini, when he came to power in 1922, October 1922, his main objective were economic austerity policies. And he, in just really quickly, all the progressive social reforms that were enacted right after the war were repressed by this type of reforms. So we had regressive tax reform, expenditure cuts, which were major. Budget decreased from 20.3 billion to 3.1 billion lira in just 3 years. Massive layoffs of public employees. There was a big reform in 1923 in which 65,000 people were fired in the public domain. Then we had drastic privatizations, for example, of the telephone companies and also of the road construction companies. And finally, monetary rigor with the Battle of the Lira that anchored back to gold and lower labor cost, flexibilization of labor. So, who was in charge of these policies? It was actually Italian academics, economic professors, who were called to cabinet. Alberto De Stefani was the first minister of finance and treasury of Mussolini's government. He was very austere. His motto was nothing for nothing, for every 100 billions of greater state income, 100 billion less expenditure. So, and he called to cabinet other prominent colleagues of his. To assist him, we had Maffeo Pantaleoni, who's a very, very famous economist, and the liberal Umberto Ricci. They were all active in governmental committees. And these men were endowed with unprecedented decision-making authority by Mussolini with the royal decree of 1923, and which is actually the act of full powers and began the period of full powers in which austerity was implemented. So these three men actually saw themselves as advisors of indisputable technocratic truth. They were the super partes guides who had to actually educate humanity to a better behavior in order to achieve economic process and economic equilibrium. And all three were actually found microeconomic reasons in support of austerity, and they all adhered to the school of pure economics, which was basically the neoliberal, neoclassical tradition stemming from the marginalist turn at the end of the 19th century. But surrounding this key governmental figure, we have a plethora of liberal economists, and actually Umberto Ricci was liberal himself, and who publicly supported austerity measures, Mussolini's austerity policies, because they considered Mussolini to be the eagerly invoked new political party who was finally strong enough to go against the will of the masses and impose austerity. And liberals and fascists alike were actually very well aware of the drastic changes that the First World War had brought about. In fact, the weaker classes were claiming greater support from the part of the state, and the democratic institutionalized system was actually entertaining their demands. So instead, for austerity to succeed, one needed top-down decision, quick decision-making, and you needed ruthless and fast action, and only Mussolini was actually, for them, able to fulfill that task at that moment. So amongst the most influential supporters of fascist economic reforms at the time was Luigi Einaudi. So Luigi Einaudi is a very famous Italian economist. He was a liberal economist, and he was our first elected president of the Republic after the fall of Mussolini after the Second World War. So he was, at the time, senator and prolific journalist. He wrote on in national press, but also he was a correspondent for The Economist. And his reportage on the success of Mussolini's economic policies were truly influential. And this I think, is very telling. He wrote on the day of the March of Rome, so when Mussolini seized power, and he asked, the important question is, what is the economic platform of the new party? Signor Mussolini, the chief, is not an economist, but passionate and full of vigor, he's able to commit his party to headlong plunges into unknown seas. For the moment, he has uttered at Naples only one economic sentence. Italy needs at the helm a man capable of saying no to all requests of new expenditures. So far, so good. So, and Mussolini, in fact, was successful. In a couple of years, he implemented orthodox fiscal policies. In a couple of years, he balanced the budget. He safeguarded creditors. And so he gained national but also international legitimization. And this is how his dictatorship was actually fully established. Obviously, behind the common cliche of Italian trains running on time, there is a much darker story of economic restructuring and of repression of the labor class. So Italy's case, I think, shows this disturbing fourfold association between austerity with liberalism, repression with fascism, austerity with repression, and finally liberalism with fascism. So this goes kind of against our common belief with us, which associates liberalism and democracy and fascism with the big state. Of course, not all of austerity is fascist, and not all fascism is austere. For example, clearly Hitler's Germany was not austere at all, and actually Mussolini pursued the German interventionist model after the crisis. Yet I think that under particular circumstances, so under the heated political circumstances after the First World War, austerity and its technocratic imprint were crucial in securing the repression of the labor class and the restoration of the pre-capitalist hierarchical capitalist order. Thank you. I'm done. Thank you.
Do we hear any questions from?
I have a question, and I feel very ignorant in asking this, but how can one learn if one doesn't ask? Has there been any thought to taxing multinationals based on the sales in specific countries, on the sales of products and on their goods and services, minus expenses for the cost of producing these, without regard to where that multinational is based?
Let's get one more question, and we'll take a couple.
Thank you. One speech shortly mentioned that Spain had much better indicators according to the Maastricht criteria than Germany. Ireland, too. And so if you talk about austerity, which is the only answer of the EU at the moment, one also has to see that they have two different cases. In the case of countries like Spain or Ireland, apparently the management of the budget was absolutely a success. It was only the socialization of the private bank's losses that created the problem. Now, if it is so, then why should you change a policy that was successful before? There is no reason for that unless you have the agenda of changing the policy. If you take this reform, if you take the crisis as a possibility to press for policies which you want to have, and Roderick wrote it once in his famous article on reforms. And as a footnote just on the Asian crisis, which was mentioned in the first paper, one could add that Malaysia did not follow this way. Malaysia took the liberty of using her rights as a member of the IMF of controlling capital flows in a relatively mild way, by the way, and escaped relatively well from the crisis. While Iceland did not take the austerity view or the austerity way, and also was a very successful case, even according to the IMF, meanwhile. Thank you.
In terms of, yes, the answer to the short answer to the question is yes, people are talking about this. They are looking for ways to deal with corporate tax havens and how to deal with corporations who already have earned profits and paid lower taxes, but they want to repatriate the funds. And so, you know, how do you deal with the subsidies that allow these corporations to get away? So, in fact, our boss spends quite a bit of time thinking through these sorts of things and proposing legislation.
Jamie, did you want?
This is more of a comment than a question, but I'd be welcome a response to it. I was listening to Clara's presentation. I was struck by the illustration it gives of the value of theory that's informed by history. And I just want to comment on how it informs my current perception of what we were doing in Greece. The strategy of the Greek government, and particularly of the finance ministry in the first 6 months of this year, was to attempt to achieve changes in the memorandum, and particularly in the policies that were being imposed on Greece in a number of specific respects, of which the most important was the completely dysfunctional program of labor market deregulation, so-called structural reform in the labor market, which was basically working to force people into the informal sector and reduce the fiscal base of the state. It was achieving nothing on the by way of employment. And our thinking was that if you made a coherent, pragmatic argument within the framework of, let's say, the limits, the acknowledged limits of what was possible fiscally, that is to say, within something that was reasonable, that sounded reasonable, that is to say, a zero or very small primary surplus, rather than new deficits, in other words, not a fiscal expansionary policy, but something that was still reasonably austere, that rational argument about what worked would have some valence and tend to have some influence on the outcome of the policy. And we got nowhere. We had no progress with this. And I think the thing that emerges from your presentation is that the point of the austerity is the behavior modification. It is what Antonia was referring to as the structural reforms, that is the purpose. And I understand, having listened to this much more clearly, what we were up against and why the exercise that we were engaged in was futile. And then certainly we knew it was very difficult, but the extent of the difficulty, I think, is clarified by this to a very considerable extent.
Well, two points. No, I agree that countries like Malaysia or Iceland avoided austerity by playing by different rules. Though Iceland had a program with IMF, the IMF tolerated, so to speak, Iceland to do certain things that were not orthodox in their way. And Malaysia, the IMF also was kind of. I agree. My most general point was that not all crises have to be followed by austerity. If you are a big enough country or you have an advantageous geopolitical situation, let's say like Mexico, a border with the US, and you don't want a very big flood of Mexican immigrants to the US, the US under Rubin and Summers, Larry Summers gave $50 billion of emergency lending to Mexico in 1994. Now, perhaps Greece was not a big threat in terms of immigration for the EU, so the EU didn't need to make a loan with a big loan without a very strict austerity. Now, the problem is that this goes beyond economics, but if, for example, that destabilization by Western powers of countries like the insertion in, let's say, in civil wars like in Libya or Syria, Ukraine, etc., is producing big emigration waves and destabilization. But we can make the similar argument with austerity. If you destabilize a country with austerity, you may have these effects on migration and destabilization of other countries. I think it's an important topic. Now, just aside on structural reforms. Structural reforms is a term that has changed meaning over time, because in the 60s and 70s, progressive policies were considered as a structural reform. Then structural reform were intended to be more like free market policies, flexibilization, so to speak, of the labor market, selling off of public enterprises, which intend to be not simple macroeconomic policies of reducing spending, improving the budget, or adjusting the exchange rate, but a change in the structural way that society, the economy operates in favor of capital and against labor or the middle class. So, but the term structural reform now has very different meaning than what it used to be, used to have.
Yes. You see, now they are a sort of a metamorphosis of words, no? The first one is austerity. When I was young, austerity was a positive connotation, no? Feature, no? It meant a serious young man or young woman. Now, in the macroeconomic, austerity is what has been said here. Is no growth, unemployment, et cetera, et cetera. This is a change of the... And this is very dangerous, because people say, why you are against austerity? The same is for structural reforms. In the 60s or 70s, in Italy, the left-wing parties, first of all, the Socialist Party, the old Socialist Party, had as a main program exactly the reform of structures. Reforms, what they mean. Did they mean nationalization or some aspects of the industry, for example, electricity. No? This was one. And more state intervention in favor of the underdeveloped part of the country, for example, Mezzogiorno in Italy. And for the labor, it was a real revolution with the Statuto dei Lavoratori. It was a fantastic progress for the labor movement. I have just mentioned two or three things to say that reform of structures meant to implement the European social model. Now, if with the same words, or almost the same, this is an adjective, structural reform, not reform of structures, you have exactly the opposite. Privatization of what remains, very little, and state intervention. No, you have explained very wonderfully this aspect for the US in the Eurozone. is the same, but is more grave, because here you have a strong critics of these aspects, not in the Eurozone. And in the end, the attack to the labor movement, this is exactly the main point of the regression, of the reactionary policy. We have to say the things as they are. In the Eurozone, there is a reactionary policy in this moment. There is also an opposition, a growing opposition. Podemos in Italy, some movement. And it is not enough to say these are populist movements. Populist, I don't know. They are against a reactionary policy. We will see. This is the...
Thank you.
A comment in the line of James. It is very important to look at what you are saying, all the panelists, in terms precisely of what Antonio's remarks are. This is part of a class warfare repertoire. So Andres mentioned that the last application of an IMF austerity program for a rich country was against Macmillan in order to break down the resistance of Labour Party and to open the doors for Margaret Thatcher and New Labour. Yeah. So this is going to be used according to the circumstances. And you have plenty of examples, for example, with Suharto, of a very generous behavior of IMF and World Bank after the massacre of half million people. So if you have this type of geopolitical merits, of course you are going to have a very lenient program. And part of that situation includes the psychological warfare that Antonio mentioned, the dispute about the sense of things. Structural reforms were always a banner, a flag from the left, in order to change ownership structures, income distribution patterns, backwardness in terms of the social organization of the space, etc. And then you have exactly the same recipe of blackmailing, of increasing blackmailing. So they imposed you upon you the type of standards that they know that they are going to be impossible to reach. And as they those goals were not achieved, they imposed further and further blackmailing. And the structural reforms started with some sensical, some apparently sensible situations about the rigidities of the markets. But then they undertook, in the case of Latin America, the reform of the justice system, the reform of the educational system. How so? In the case of Ecuador, they were imposing the elimination of the budget for the universities. Because it was, our country had a vocation only for primary education and very low aggregate value for export. You know, that is the type of condemnation that you are buying for Europe and maybe for the same United States. Because the next discussion about debt ceiling is just a political manipulation, because you have the 14th Amendment, in which all the time you have always the possibility of flexibilizing those limits in order to avoid any type of restrictions in terms of macroeconomic policy. So that is the use of macroeconomic policy as part of the taming of the working classes, and the, not only the working classes, but of the subaltern classes in the society.
Take a shot. Yeah, we get one more question. I think maybe we'll stop after that.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you. Yes, I have a question to Stephanie. I liked the presentation. I thought the recommendations you made at the end were actually rather similar to some of the ones I made for the euro area in a slightly different way. A couple of questions. What do you think of the golden rule, taking out public investment and otherwise having a balanced development of the current budget over the cycle. You were implicitly critical of Krugman and Bernanke for sort of saying austerity later, but weren't the measures you propose, isn't that also in a sense just saying, okay, when the economy improves, then, you know, if you bump up the value of the automatic stabilizers, you essentially get a restrictive policy when the economy is booming. So isn't that actually the same sort of thing you're recommending? I was a bit unclear about that. And the last thing is about the external position. So you said given that the States has a normal sort of current account deficit, I don't know, 2-3% or something. And from what I've picked up of the U.S. progressive economist discussion, some people like Dean Baker and others are sort of arguing that this should be closed, right? That the balance should be closer to zero. I don't know what your view is on that. And that presumably then would affect your recommendation for the fiscal stance. So I'd be just interested in your views.
Those are good questions. So, the golden rule. What was the golden? How did you describe the golden rule? Oh, right. Capital budgeting. Capital budgeting. Well, look, I think this is one of those sorts of things that, you know, somebody like Bob Eisner used to propose capital budgeting. My best guess, because I was too young at the time to have been paying attention during those debates, but that this was mainly a pragmatic attempt to get more government spending in areas of importance and to keep them off budget for politically expedient sort of maneuver. So in some sense it's a gimmick, it's a budgeting gimmick, but now that I'm in DC I have a new appreciation for budget gimmicks, so I might be more sympathetic than I would have been last year to just a more unapologetic defense of the use of spending, right? Whether it's deficit spending or not. In terms of the deficit dove versus the hawk position, I do think there is a difference. When I talk about turbocharging the automatic stabilizers, you're not imposing austerity. The stabilizers are working like shock absorbers, and so they are responding naturally to changes in real economic conditions. They're not adding from the outside, right, an exogenous tightening of spending or higher taxes. They're allowing the budget to move where the budget needs to move to accommodate changes in largely non-government spending, right? So it's much more akin to, like, you know, an Abelerner functional finance, where if I had more time, I would have developed some of those arguments that Lerner made. But the basic point would be to use the budget as a tool to achieve broader macroeconomic goals like full employment and price stability. And whether the budget is in surplus, deficit, or balance is largely irrelevant. What matters is, have you achieved full employment and do you have relatively low inflation, right? And then you use the tools to battle one or both of those evils when they emerge. So, and then the third question was about the external. You're right, and that is mostly what I'm gonna do tomorrow. So in the case of the U.S., but you raise a good point, because if in the case of the U.S. we're running current account deficits on the order of 3% of GDP or more, which we are, and at the same time we've got government deficits that are only around 2.5% of GDP, which they are, then by definition we're leaving the domestic private sector in the red, and the budget deficit is simply not large enough in that example to offset what's going on with the trade deficit. So Dean and I have had these discussions. Dean would like to simply depreciate the currency. That's sort of one way that he likes to go about thinking about how to engineer job creation and growth, is a depressed currency. Now, this is obviously not a strategy that's going to work for everybody, right?
You want to take question?
Oh, the political, no, I'm going to leave that to my allies in Europe on the, I think, let somebody else, you want to tackle the power and the politics, and I agree, I'm broadly, I agree.
No, I agree with Pedro. I think it matters. I mean, the probability of a country having to enter in a tough or in austerity program will depend on various things. First, if you are a, because you enter in austerity basically because of debt, because otherwise you wouldn't have you could finance an imbalance, a fiscal imbalance, the current account imbalance, etc. So if the U.S. has more leeway because the U.S. dollar is the reserve currency in the world economy, therefore at the end it could pay the deficit with depreciated dollars. Now it's appreciating, but for other reasons. So if you have a reserve currency, you're in a very different position. The UK in the 70s, the sterling, the pound, was not for decades had ceased to be the reserve currency. So I tend to agree with your interpretation that perhaps they wanted to curb the unions and then prepare the Thatcher. I don't know, I'm not sure, but maybe. But the thing is that the UK had to borrow in World War I and World War II from the US, so it was they depended from the US. So I would say that your debt situation, whether you have reserve currency, and whether your country is large enough to have a geopolitical bargaining power. If you are a small economy, you are Greece. It's very complicated. The countries, in that sense, before entering a monetary union or entering the European Union, they have to evaluate what degrees of freedom, what influence they will have in the case events go wrong. That's the problem. I listened in the morning discussion on the EU, whether entering or leaving. I think that the EU would avoid leaving the EU. The problem is the EU is not a union among equals. So that's I think that depends on, that will affect the probability of austerity. Latin America always had to adopt austerity policies because it had very little chance to break the circle. It depended on the US dollar, trade and investment depended also on the dollar area. Except for the risk of revolution, there was no serious reason to press creditors for more money. That started in the 80s. I don't know.
Okay, thanks to our